The Call of the Canyon, a Western romance by Zane Grey, narrated by John Rayburn. A young veteran of World War I in poor health heads to Arizona to try and recover. He meets young Flo Hunter, who successfully nurses him. However, life gets more complicated when his fiancée, Carley Burch, comes to him from back east. However, she winds up not liking life in the West and goes back to New York. Flo gets badly injured in an accident, and vet Glenn Kilbourne wants to repay her for her assistance and proposes marriage. As wedding day approaches, Carley decides she made a mistake and returns to Arizona looking for him. Flo realizes they're still in love, calls off the marriage, and meets another man. The very involved tale of overall compassion affords pleasant listening to details. Chapter 1. What subtle, strange message had come to her from out of the West? Carley Burch laid the letter in her lap and gazed dreamily through the window. It was a day typical of early April in New York, rather cold and gray with steely sunlight. Spring breathed in the air, but the women passing along 57th Street wore furs and wraps. She heard the distant clatter of an L train, and then the hum of a motor car. A hurdy-gurdy jarred into the interval of quiet. "Glenn has been gone over a year," she mused. "3 months over a year. And of all his strange letters, this seems the strangest yet." She lived again for the thousandth time the last moment she had spent with him. It had been on New Year's Eve, 1918. They had called upon friends who were staying at the McAlpin in a suite on the 21st floor overlooking Broadway. And when the last quarter hour of that eventful and tragic year began slowly to pass with the low swell of whistles and bells, Carley's friends had discreetly left her alone with her lover at the open window to watch and hear the old year out, the new year in. Glenn Kilbourne had returned from France early that fall, shell-shocked and gassed and otherwise incapacitated for service in the army, a wreck of his former sterling self and in many unaccountable ways a stranger to her. Cold, silent, haunted by something, he had made her miserable with his aloofness. But as the bells began to ring out the year that had been his ruin, Glenn had drawn her close, tenderly, passionately, and yet strangely, too. "Carley, look and listen," he had whispered. Under them stretched the great long white flare of Broadway, with its snow-covered length glittering under a myriad of electric lights. Sixth Avenue swerved away to the right, a less brilliant lane of blanched snow. The L trains crept along like huge fire-eyed serpents. The hum of the ceaseless moving line of motor cars drifted upward faintly, almost drowned in the rising clamor of the street. Broadway's gay and thoughtless crowd surged to and fro. From that height, merely a thick stream of black figures like contending columns of ants on the march. And everywhere the monstrous electric signs flared up, vivid in white and red and green, and dimmed and paled, only to flash up again. Ring out the old, ring in the new. Carley had poignantly felt the sadness of the one, the promise of the other. As one by one the siren factory whistles opened up with deep, hoarse bellows, the clamor of the street and the ringing of the bells were lost in a volume of continuous sound that swelled on high into a magnificent roar. It was the voice of a city, of a nation. It was the voice of a people crying out the strife and the agony of the year, pealing forth a prayer for the future. Glenn had put his lips to her ear. "It's like the voice in my soul." Never would she forget the shock of that, and how she had stood spellbound, enveloped in the mighty volume of sound no longer discordant, but full of great pregnant melody, until the white ball burst upon the tower of the Times building, showing up the figures 1919. The new year had not been many minutes old when Glenn Kilbourne had told her he was going west to try to recover his health. Carley roused out of her memories to take up the letter that had so perplexed her. It bore the postmark Flagstaff, Arizona. She reread it with slow, pondering thoughtfulness. West Fark, March 25, Dear Carley, it does seem my neglect in writing you is unpardonable. I used to be a pretty fair correspondent, but in that, as in other things, I have changed. One reason I have not answered sooner is because your letter was so sweet and loving that it made me feel an ungrateful and unappreciative wretch. Another is that this life I now lead does not induce writing. I am outdoors all day, and when I get back to this cabin at night, I'm too tired for anything but bed. Your imperious questions I must answer, and that must, of course, is a third reason why I have delayed my reply. First you ask, don't you love me any more as you used to? Frankly, I do not. I am sure my old love for you before I went to France was selfish.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.